نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. القرآن رحمة الله إلينا. The Quran is the mercy from Allah to us. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ. So if you want to have access to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran is the way. وَيَا إِخْوَى, there is no bounty greater than this bounty, convening and meeting in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to study the Quran. في صحيح الإمام مسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم says, ما جلس قوم في بيت من بيوت الله يتلون كتاب الله ويتدارسونه فيما بينهم إلا. A group of people convening, sitting in one of the houses of Allah in order to study the book of Allah, they will receive the following. Number one, نزلت عليهم السكينة. The tranquility, the peace, the serenity will fall upon them, will be above them. Two, وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ, and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will engulf them. Number three, وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, and the angels will surround this gathering. Four, وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will name you in a company which is a lot better than the human, which is the company of the angels. The hadith, ya ikhwa, fi sahih al-imam Muslim. It's authentic, of course. طيب. Ya ikhwa, look at this hadith. يُقَالُ لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ. It will be said to صاحب القرآن. صاحب القرآن, the person who takes the Quran as a friend, صاحب from the companionship. You know, the Quran is your companion, is your buddy. You recite it sometimes, you listen to it sometimes, you reflect upon it sometimes. That's a recite in the Day of Judgment. And elevate yourself, arise. Indeed, your status will be in accordance with the last verse you recited in this world. فنسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يرزقنا الإخلاص. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He bestows upon us sincerity so we get some of these ultimate rewards which are mentioned in these ahadith. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I decided to explain Juz Tabarak. That is the name of the Juz. That is Juz number 29. And this may take a year or two, because we're talking about 11 chapters. من المفصل, a Quran that is short. Number one, Surah Al-Mulk. Two, Surah al-Qalam, the pen. What does al-Mulk means? The dominion, the sovereignty. Al-Qalam. Three, al-Haqqah, the inevitable. Four, al-Ma'arij, in reference to the angels who ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Five, Nuh, Surah Nuh. Number six, al-Jinn. Number seven, al-Muzzammil. Number eight, al-Muddaththir. Number nine, al-Qiyamah. Number 10, al-Insan. Number 11, al-Mursalat. Tamam kida, Sheikh Eid? The order is fine? Tamam. So those are 11 chapters from the Quran. They are short. Each one of them is 1.5 page, sometimes 2 plus, yani more or less, inshallah. So it won't be as extensive as you may think, inshallah. Very quickly, بإذن الله تعالى. Normally, يا إخوة, I'll learn this. Learn this. Anyone who takes on the task of explaining the Quran, there is an important question that you ask that person. What is your manhaj? There is something called manahij al-mufassirin. Because listen, the books of Tafsir, over 100 of them out there, and a lot of people has taken on that mission of explaining the Quran, but what is your manhaj? What methodology do you follow to explain the book of Allah? Do you just grab the Quran and explain it yourself based on your own understanding? Or do you go back to those who explained it before you? Do you go after the apparent meaning, or you go after hidden meanings? Like mystic Sufis do, extreme Sufis do. They say the Quran has an apparent meaning and has a hidden meaning. So what is your manhaj? What is your methodology? And this is very important. Don't just listen to someone who explains the Quran just without clarifying and verifying his manhaj. Listen, if you're a learned person, you can go ahead and dig into those who explain the Quran from Ahlul Bid'ah. There is no problem with that, provided that you know what you're doing. But if you don't know what you're doing, you're going to sit in front of somebody who follows Bid'ahs in explaining the Quran, and you're going to believe him. And this is what you don't want. Sometimes I go and look into books of Tafsir that I know the authors belong to schools of Bid'ah. But I'm trying to find out what they are saying so you can refute it if you're a learned person. But a layman Muslim, you know, that is the question that you should ask. What is your manhaj of tafsir right away? Now, to find out the methodology of tafsir, the mufassir, now get used to those words. Tafsir is the explanation of the Quran. Mufassir is the one who does what? Does the tafsir. Now, how do I find out, how do I discover his methodology? First of all, he should disclose it. And this is what I'm going to disclose to you right now. Based on what? I'm going to explain the Quran. I'm going to disclose my manhaj to you. What manhaj I'm following to explain the Quran for you. This is actually the ideal. But unfortunately, the people of Bid'ah, they never do this. You open and you go on, and you find out in the midst, this guy is really off track completely. So normally, any mufassir would right away at the beginning of his book of tafsir would explain the methodology he follows to explain the Quran. Or of course, if he does not disclose this, certainly a learned person can do something called istiqra, discovering what he does, discovering the way that he follows. Fa-insha'Allah, ya ikhwa, my manhaj in explaining Juz' Tabarak, insha'Allah, is at-tafsir bil-ma'thur. I follow the manhaj, اللي هو الايه, tafsir bil-ma'thur, that I find out what the Quran said about the verse. So the Quran explains the Quran. That's the first place you should go to. Because, you see, the Quran is a speech. Al-Qur'an kalam, not a book. Normally when someone speaks, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى, and to Allah belongs the best example, sometimes he would say something and later on he would detail it. He would explain it. Or maybe he would say something that is general, and later on he said, you know what, let's make this particular to certain. So the best one to explain what they say is the speaker himself. And we believe Al-Qur'an kalamullah, Al-Qur'an, Allah spoke this kalam, this Al-Qur'an, Allah spoke it subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that suits His Majesty. In a way that suits His Majesty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke this. Now, the question here is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes He would explain certain things in a different place. I tell you, ideal example. We say in the salah, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, guide us to the straight path. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, the path of those upon whom you bestowed your favor. First of all, what favor and who are those? Money is a favor, right? Money is a ni'mah, right? Children is a ni'mah, right? صحيح? Isn't that all? We can, health is a ni'mah, right? Knowledge is a ni'mah, right? So what ni'mah are we talking about here? An'amta alayhim. What did he bestow upon them? Shuf, this is al-Fatiha. You know, this is explained in a chapter called An-Nisa, which is later on. Look at this. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Indeed, those who obey Allah and His Messenger are with those upon whom Allah bestowed His favor. So now, so when I say صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, you're asking Allah to guide you to obey Allah and His Messenger. That's the ni'mah that you want, the bounty that you want. But again, I'm trying to tell you how the Quran does what. And I want to tell you something. This is the methodology the companions themselves followed. Imagine Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, al-hadith al-Bukhari. One day the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Ya ibn Mas'ud, ibn Mas'ud, iqra alayhi al-Quran. Recite the Quran to me. Imagine this. Imagine the messenger upon whom the Quran was revealed requesting his disciple, his companion, to recite the revelation to him. He said, Ya Rasulullah, aqra'ahu alayka wa alayka unzil. How am I going to recite it to you when it was revealed to you? He said, إِنِّي أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَسْمَعَهُ مِنْ غَيْرِي. I love to hear it from others. Pay attention to this. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, لَقَدْ أَخَذْتُ سَبْعِينَ سُورَةً مِنْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. I have heard 70 chapters from the book, from the Quran, from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Imagine this. I'm just giving you the status of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, خذوا القرآن من أربع. Learn the Quran from four. Not just the recitation of the Quran, the understanding of the Quran. Guess who was number one on that list? Ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. معاذ ibn Jabal, معاذ ibn Jabal, وسالم مولى أبي حذيفة, وأبي ibn Ka'b. Four. In spite of this, look at this. One day one of the people asked him, Ya Ibn Mas'ud, what is the meaning of what Allah said in a chapter called Ghafir? قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَمَتَّنَا اثْنَتَيْنِ وَأَحْيَيْتَنَا اثْنَتَيْنِ فَاعْتَرَفْنَا بِذُنُوبِنَا فَهَلْ إِلَىٰ خُرُوجٍ مِّن سَبِيلٍ. The kuffar, the disbelievers, the polytheists will say to God, to Allah in the Day of Judgment, O Allah, You made us die twice and live twice. So the questioner is asking Ibn Mas'ud, what does it mean that we die twice and we live twice? Look, what did Ibn Mas'ud say? In spite of his status, in spite of his knowledge, he still followed that methodology. He said, تُفَسِّرُهَا آيَةُ الْبَقَرَةِ. This is Ghafir, towards the end of the Quran. Al-Baqarah is the second chapter. The verse in chapter 2 explains it. What verse? كيف تكفرون بالله وكنتم أمواتا فأحياكم ثم يميتكم ثم يحييكم. Those are the four. How are you going to disbelieve in Allah when you were dead? So before this life we were dead, right? Where did you exist before this life? Where? هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا. We had no mention. Who called you to this world? Who did? So you were dead and then he given you life. So this is death and life. Then what is going to happen after this life? Die. So this is three. And then what is going to happen after death, after being buried in the ground? Resurrection. So those are the four. Two and two. Two death and two up and two lives. Oh. You see? So how the Quran explained the Quran? You're getting the point? You're getting the point or no? So, because the Quran is Kalamullah, Allah spoke it. When somebody speaks, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى, to Allah belongs the best example. He is the best one to explain what he said. صحيح ولا لا؟ Not somebody coming in and, Sheikh, you said this. Somebody, Sheikh, you said this. You meant this and this. What do you mean, I mean? I meant this and this. No, you mean this. No, I who's entitled to explain what you said? Me, not you. So, this is how the Quran explains the Quran. طب, if there is no explanation for the verse in the Quran, where should you go? Who? The one who received the Quran. Who received the Quran? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sunnah, al-Hadith. And this is why you always find in the compiled books of Ahadith, always, you will find كتاب التفسير. شوف صحيح البخاري كتاب التفسير, the book of explanation of the Quran. في صحيح مسلم كتاب التفسير. سنن الترمذي كتاب التفسير. سنن النسائي always the book of تفسير. Always where they mention the ahadith which explains what the Quran. Because you need to understand that Jibreel alayhi salam would come and explain to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't we read that in Ramadan Jibreel would come and review the Quran with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Don't you dare think just the revision of the recitation. لا يدارسه مدارسة القرآن. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to be the most generous of all. وكان أجود ما يكون في رمضان. But his generosity would increase in the month of Ramadan. That's why we raise funds in Ramadan always. His generosity would increase in the month of Ramadan. Why? Because of the Quran. That's why a lot of people they give in Ramadan. Why a lot of people give in Ramadan more than any other month? Because of the Quran. Because why? When Jibreel would come and review the Quran with him. صحيح. So the Quran explains the Quran, then where do you go to? The Sunnah explains the Quran. Number three, the disciples of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, the companions. When they did not understand something, they would go to who? To the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right away, they would ask him. And sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you know what, I didn't understand myself and I asked Jibreel about it. And here is what it means. So this is three. Number four, the second best and the third best generations of the predecessors. We call them the students of the disciples. You see, there are three generations in this ummah, the best. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, خير الناس, the best of the people are my generation. ثم الذين يلونهم, then the students, the second best. ثم الذين يلونهم, then the third best. So the students that the companions produced in order to explain the Quran. Now, if you do not find the Quran explains the Quran, the Sunnah explains the Quran, the Sahabi explains the Quran, the Tabi explains the Quran, then you go after what? Al-Lugha, the Arabic language. Then you go after the language. It is a big, big, big mistake. And this is what these brothers do. Some young brothers, they mashallah, yani, they are very eloquent and they are very good, but they use the language. That's the language. He calls the Quran and he explains that. If you just use the language, I'll give you one example. If you're going to use the language to explain the Quran, طيب, the verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah and Surah Al-Nisa regarding الوضوء. When do you have to make wudu? One of the things, أو لامستم النساء. أو لامستم النساء. One of the causes for you to do ablution, to wash up in order to pray. Literally, if you take the language, illams, what is illams in language? So if you touch a female, you have to make wudu. What do you think about that? If you're just going to use the language now, if you're going to skip that sequence, you see, that's the sequence. The Quran explains the Quran, the Sunnah explains the Quran, huh? The Sahabi explains the Quran, the predecessor explains the Quran, then what? The language. Now if you're going to leave those four and jump to the language, what is going to happen? What is going to happen? You're going to get that understanding that if you touch a woman, you have to go and wash up again. طيب, we read that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make wudu, used to make ablution before the salah, and in his way out, he used to kiss his wife. What do you think about that? Well, in Nisa here, whether your wife or not your wife, it doesn't matter. طيب, here it is. اللمس في اللغة. Abdullah ibn Abbas explained the meaning of اللمس here, الجماع. Intercourse or arousing with desire. That is what is meant. Again, if you jump, the ideal thing. Huh? That's the famous Fox News piece. Kill the infidels where you find them. Snipe them. Listen, this is in the Quran. Do you deny that this is in the Quran? It is in the Quran. But you see what Fox did, they jumped to the language. But they don't realize that there is an incident that happened, and that incident governs our understanding of this verse. What incident? You see, the house of Allah in Mecca was surrounded with what? Idols. Towards the end of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah commanded him to clean his house from these idols. Because you're going to go do Hajj, and you cannot do Hajj while these idols are around the Kaaba. So now, out of respect for those people, give them a 4-month notice, warning. 4 months, you have 4 months to vacate the Kaaba from your idols and live in peace. After 4 months, we are at war with you. Now the Arabs in the past, pay attention to this. You know, if somebody would kill somebody outside and he would go sit next to the Kaaba, no one there would approach that person until he goes out. The Kaaba had sanctity. No one is allowed to touch anybody who seeks refuge in the Kaaba. So you would go and harm somebody outside, and you would go sit inside the Kaaba. As long as you're inside the Kaaba, no one is what? Allowed to touch you. So now, after 4 months, what if those people are still inside the Kaaba? Then Allah is telling them, it's still war. You could kill them there if they are fighting you from there. If the fighting from there, you could do that. So now you understand what? The text properly. Insha'Allah, ya ikhwah, in closing, inshallah, we don't want to prolong this. But I want to create some suspense for the next lecture, inshallah. My manhaj, my methodology is to follow this. The Quran explains the Quran. The Sunnah explains the Quran. The Sahabi explains the Quran. The Tabi'i explains the Quran. And then I go after the language. And I found my peace and my comfort in two books that follow that manhaj. Ibn Kathir and Tafsir al-Jalālayn. Two individuals called al-Suyuti and al-Mahalli, his name. Inshallah, I'm going to base my explanation of Juz Tabarak upon those two books, inshallah. Of course, I need to get your attention to something. For me to go after every little word, every little verse, this will prolong this. And I'm trying to make this as short and sweet as possible. And normally it's not very beneficial for non-Arab speaking. You know, it would be fun if all of you are Arab speaking, and you know, it would be a lot of fun for me to do this. But really, I'm gonna guide you in each one of these chapters, in two or three lectures, how to understand it, what is the theme of that chapter, and what's it about. Inshallah, the first chapter that we have is Al-Mulk, a chapter called Al-Mulk. What does Al-Mulk mean? Dominion, sovereignty, what else? Kingdom, that Allah, God, is the king. He owns everything. Now, there is one virtue of this chapter that was established. Whoever recites it every night, the hadith, yani, inshallah, I'm going to go over its authenticity with you, but overall, hasan. Overall, hasan. Whoever recites it every night, Allah will protect him from the punishment in the grave. For that chapter has a virtue, it will protect you from the punishment in the grave if you understand it and recite it every night. Now, what is the wisdom behind this? Why this particular chapter protect you from the punishment in the grave? This is what we will explain next lecture, inshallah.
Because Juz Tabarak is big, and you said first it's going to take about a year or a year and a half. And instead of we do one night, can we do two nights?
Yeah, inshallah, maybe gradually if we see you interested, inshallah, we'll do it, inshallah. But inshallah, that's the question that we're going to answer next, bi-idhnillah, next Wednesday. Jazakumullahu khaira, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Barakallahu feekum. هنعمل يومين حاضر.